Max Persson här och det är dags för den fjärde och sista intervjun från World Golf Fitness Summit. Denna gång med idrottspsykologen Brett McCabe. Några av er kanske har hört talas om hans namn genom hans egen podcast, The Mindside Podcast. Eller genom mina rekommendationer för just densamma. Eller bara, ni kanske har hört namnet förut. Han är en väldigt framstående idrottspsykolog i USA. Han jobbar med flera spelare på både PGA och RPGA-touren. Han arbetar bland annat, eller har bland annat arbetat med Camilla Lennart, svenska golfspelerskan. Han arbetar inte bara med golfare heller utan med andra idrottslag eller andra idrotter, och det är riktigt häftigt att lyssna på hans kunskap och hans erfarenheter. Och han har själv varit en elitutövare på väldigt hög nivå som baseballspelare faktiskt en gång i tiden. Han är extremt kunnig. Det var en diskussion som jag satt vid och bara häpnade över hans kunskap och hur bra han faktiskt var. Och han har hjälpt mig lite tidigare genom diverse frågor kring mina spelare, och han har verkligen varit en intressant person att ha att göra med, för han är så extremt kunnig. Och idag i intervjun så pratar vi väldigt, väldigt mycket om just prestation. Han är en prestationsspecialist nu för tiden, om vi säger att han hjälper golfare, andra idrottsutövare att helt enkelt prestera, ta fram det som krävs för att prestera på absolut högsta nivå. Och det är också det som vi vill göra, oavsett vilken nivå av golfare vi är, så vill vi ju faktiskt prestera efter vår absoluta toppnivå så ofta som bara möjligt. Och det är just det vi kommer att diskutera idag. Brett ger bland annat sin syn på prestation just för amatörgolf, som vi kallar det, alltså oss som inte lever på att spela golf. Hur man kan verkligen se till att man presterar på ett bättre sätt, tränar på ett bättre sätt, vilket naturligtvis är jätteintressant eftersom det är väldigt, väldigt viktigt för golfare på alla nivåer, och också lite om mitt intresse. Vi pratar också en hel del om hur hans egna erfarenheter kan hjälpa egentligen alla golfare på. Och det är egentligen det vi kommer fokusera på idag. Prestation för spelare på alla nivåer, eller alla amatörspelare kan man säga, oavsett om de har 2 i handikapp eller de har 36. Hur man liksom kommer över det här att tycka så illa om det man gör, hur man faktiskt tycker det är kul ute på golfbanan, hur man kan lägga upp sin träning efter det. Han ger några riktigt bra tips, en bit in i hur alla golfare egentligen borde se sin golf och hur viktigt det är att se sin golf på rätt sätt om man faktiskt vill prestera på det på absolut bästa sätt. Vilket han också naturligtvis kommer in på och säger att det spelar ingen roll om det är en 36-handikappare, en 2-handikappare eller en PGA-tourspelare. Många, eller de absolut flesta av golfarna har exakt samma problem när det gäller just hur man ser sin egen golf och sin egen prestation. Han har så mycket bra att säga i den sista halvan, ska vi säga, av den här intervjun kring just det. Hur viktigt det är att vi som golfare faktiskt har rätt syn på oss själva och vår prestation om vi vill förvänta oss att prestera på absolut bästa sätt. Är det någonting du ska ta med dig så är det verkligen det. Jag anser till och med, efter att ha lyssnat på det ett par gånger i den här redigeringen, det här är någonting som alla golfare helt enkelt behöver. Det här är någonting som alla golfare, oavsett nivå, skulle tjäna väldigt, väldigt mycket på. Lyssna på en av branschens främsta när det gäller det här. Lär dig kring hur du kan se din golf annorlunda och på så vis förbättra dina resultat. Vi hoppar igång med en gång. Vi drar till New Orleans World Golf Fitness Summit och min intervju med Dr. Brett McCabe. World Golf Fitness Summit, jag sitter här tillsammans med en stor inspiration och motivator för mig, kan jag väl säga, Dr. Brett McCabe.
Yes.
How should I introduce you? How could you introduce yourself?
Absolutely. I'm a licensed clinical psychologist. I have my PhD in clinical psychology, specializing in what we call behavioral medicine, which is how the mind and body interact. So somebody who has chronic medical conditions, do they get better with the way that they psychologically function, or do those medical conditions cause psychological deterioration? And then I also, I'm a sports psychologist, so my main focus, 100% of my focus in my practice, is working with athletes to either get them through injury or to get them to perform better.
I found you through your podcast, the Mindside Podcast. I actually don't remember how I found it, but I found it. I know how long we've been going on.
We've been doing the podcast for about 18 months.
All right.
It started because Jason Glass, the Jason Glass podcast, I was on as a guest of his a couple times, and we started talking. He's like, you really need to get this out there, and you need to get out and do a podcast. And I sat on it for about 6 months. And then I started looking at it saying, what a great way to interview people that I'm interested in. And if I'm interested, then I can learn something. And so we've really been spending a lot of time learning and understanding the type of clients we want to interview, but I've been blown away by the individual stories. The goal behind the podcast is that there's great people around us.
Yep.
We don't have to go find them. We just need to look and listen to the people around us, and if we do that, we'll learn something. So we've had everything from elite athletes and Olympian athletes to people who have had major tragedy in their life and are working through it.
I'm coming from the golf side, and of course my viewers and my listeners are coming from the golf side, and I can just say that it's far from a golf podcast.
Correct.
But I learned so much for me and my clients I work with through listening to some of those stories that you're talking about, that it's just, they are in golf, but they can help me understand the mental part of the game.
Yeah, you know, I'm a big believer, like, we can spend a lot of time studying theory and process of human behavior,
yep.
which is important, but we can also learn through doing, and we can also learn, people always ask me, what's the best sports psychology books that you can buy? And to me, they're biographies of people who are not in sports. So it may be great historical leaders, it may be people who've gone through tragedy in their life, it may be people who've bounced back, or military leaders who had to make hard decisions, those types of books. And so if you can, so that's the goal of the podcast, is even though it's not a golf-focused one, because I work with all sports, is what can I learn and what can I bring to the table that maybe you as a player or a 17-year-old kid who maybe would never picked up a book on being an elite military operator, but they can learn in the hour podcast. I think it can be very helpful.
It's not a golf podcast, and you're not only working with golfers.
Correct.
What kind of athletes are you working with? Are they elite athletes? Or are they
all the around. So I work with about 10 professional golfers on all the major tours. All
right.
Top-ranked players in the world. But I also work with juniors. I work with amateurs. I work with all sports. I'm a sports psychologist and consulting psychologist for one of the largest athletic departments in the country in the university setting. And so I work across those spectrums. But I've got athletes that I've got corporate leaders that I work with on how to speak better, how to communicate. And to me, you know, I always say, people say, oh, I learned a lot. And I'm like, no, I learned more from you than you learned from me. Because to me, our lives are nothing but an interaction playground. So everybody we interact with, we got to be learning something from them. So when I'm working with somebody, whatever sport, I do a lot of work with gymnasts. I'm 6'5". I've never tumbled a day in my life on purpose. So if they tell me what to do, like, well, when I'm at the end of the runway before I go on the ball, this is what I want to be thinking. All right, let's figure it out. They teach me. And what's amazing by doing that is they're actually teaching themselves. So
it sounds like kind of a fun work.
It's a great job.
Yeah. Zooming into my kind of viewer and my kind of followers, like the amateur golfers.
Yeah.
I have a lot of followers and watchers who they want to be the best they can be. They can't spend 20 hours a week working on the golf game. They're not playing 4 rounds a week, but they want to be the best. Like, do you have any general tips and ideas for this?
So golfers, a couple flaws we have in golf.
Yeah.
The first flaw is that we train to fix. So when we go to the golf course and go to the range, I have a lesson with you. You're like, okay, you need to do this or that. Now I go to the golf course. Every time I go to the golf course or to the range, I'm trying to fix that problem with the belief that if I fix the problem, then all of a sudden I'll play better. It's kind of backwards. It's kind of like we have all these ingredients. It's how those ingredients come together to create a great recipe, not the fact that I have really good ingredients. Now, do I need to fix problems? Absolutely. But my mindset needs to be much more focused on execution. So here's where that gap falls. The average golfer, which means, let me say average, saying 95% of all people I work with, including in the professional ranks, judge their performance by their best days. So in their mind, when they show up at the golf course, let's say they're a 5 handicap, they think even par is the standard. But a 5 handicap's not shooting even par.
Nope.
Okay, statistically, they probably should shoot that, 10% of the time?
Somewhere around that.
Okay, so why are we using 10% of the time to be our standard? So now if they shoot a 77, okay, they're upset. That's their average, right?
Yep.
So instead of being frustrated going, I shot 77, so okay, look, I shot my average. If we look at statistical sciences, our average occurs. We're going to be if we look at a normal distribution, the bell curve, that's going to occur about 65% of the time between one standard deviation, 67% of the time. So that means our most frequently occurring scores, our statistical average, and our median are all going to be within one standard deviation of the average. So if I'm a five handicap, I go out and think I'm going to shoot par. I get pressure on the fourth hole because I'm four over par. Guess what I still am? I'm still within my average. So instead of getting mad and being frustrated, I go, wait a minute, can I shave a shot somewhere? One shot. If I can make that five handicap of four, that four, three, a three, a two, a two, a 1.5, a one, now those low scores become really good. Now, here's the other problem. So let's say I do go out and I have a bad day. I shoot 84. It happens. The mentality is go fix something, hurry up, call you. Oh my God. Versus going, wait a minute, I've got these tools. Go back to what I'm trained to do. That's as much a statistical anomaly as shooting a 68. But where we get in trouble is we sabotage ourselves because we're getting angry because our ego says, don't play bad, that's embarrassing. So now when we're sitting seven over, we're panicking and we start testing new ideas versus going, let me learn from this round. So this happened to me the other day. I'm a low handicap, I'm about a two handicap. Don't get to play a lot. I only hit balls when I play. I don't hit balls in between because of work. But I'm on the golf course every day. It's probably like you.
Yep.
Okay. So I go play on Saturday. I shoot even. It was good. It wasn't anything sexy, but it was good.
Yep.
The next day, I was seven over through six.
I can relate.
Okay. It just went away. Now, some of it was related to things that I was doing. I wasn't warming up properly. I hurried up and rushed, got to the tee because I was excited I was going to play again. You name it. So on the eighth hole, I decided I'm going to hit a driving iron off the tee. It's the one hole that has a little dogleg with a golf cart with a cart path that runs in the middle of it. I hit the best driving iron all day, hits the cart path and bounces out of bounds. And you gotta understand, when we evaluate human performance, there's five things that can dictate how we play bad. And we're gonna look for massive trends. The first one is bad preparation. I didn't prepare good. I didn't get a chance to hit a lot of balls. I've been sick, I've been tired. Let's say the range is under weather, underwater, whatever. I had bad. It could be bad strategy. I chose to go out and play and thought I was gonna be aggressive today when really I should have been playing to the fatter part of the green, whatever. A strategy set me up for failure. It's bad execution. I executed poorly. Bad mental focus. I couldn't let go of bad things. And then there are some days we just have bad luck. The lottery number that day comes up and it says, you will stink today. Okay. Well, if we pull the number and we're going to be great today, we can't look at ourselves as being a superstar when that happens and a loser when the bad one comes up. Instead, go, okay, if I play enough golf, I'm going to have those.
Yep.
Let's get back to let's use the doubt and disappointment to funnel discipline and discipline to our plan.
Wow, that's amazing. Like, I recognize myself so much in that. I think every golfer does, no matter what level.
All the time.
And just
I played in a, before I came down to this conference, we have like a Ryder Cup thing at our course. We have two courses, so we played each other.
Right.
I won the first two matches. It was four ball and foursome. And then on Sunday morning, I tee off. I'm two up through two. I miss a three-footer for birdie. Should have given it to me, but anyway, obviously it worked for him. Okay, I three-putted for par, which made it even worse. But anyway, I'd get up to three up, and I'd always lose it. I'd get up to three up, I'd go down to it. So I get up to three up with four to go, and I lost the match. Now, this is what I do for a living. I played a bad hole. I made a bad decision.
Yep.
I dropped the ball, not realizing my ball was still in play. I thought it was in the hazard, so now I had to play the ball in play. The guy makes an eagle on the next hole by holding it out from the fairway. And then I got tight, frustrated, and anxious. And I lost the last two. I lost. Now, our team won, but I lost. I was so disappointed. It was bad mental focus. 100%. So instead of looking at it going, I'm a loser, I look at it and go, I could be better there.
And that's growth mindset, isn't it?
Yes. I'm always improving.
Oh, that's awesome. You're working with a lot of like the highest level of players. Is that part of the game still there?
Oh, yeah. They do the same things that you and I do.
All right.
They just do it on a bigger stage. Now, the difference between the elite players is that their talent is so exquisite. Their ability to overcome deficiencies because they're talented is at a much higher level. Now, where does that talent come from? Some of it's born.
Yep.
Some of it's just hard work. So they refine their skill sets so that they may not think great on the course, but they're so good with an 8-iron from 170 yards that they can hit it really tight. Some players are really good at letting things go, and other players will hold on to it. But some of those that hold on to it use that to funnel their focus and their adrenaline. So everybody has their own pathway.
And so a lot of it's just finding that pathway.
So it's the hunt to that is finding who you are,
yeah,
and learning through kind of experimentation. Look, life is a learning playground. It's an interactive playground.
Yeah.
If you're not learning, that's the growth mindset, right? You've got to learn. If you don't learn, I believe that you're going to repeat the lesson. It's just going to come in louder, harder, and more difficult. So instead of labeling everything as negative, why don't we look at it and say, I got my butt kicked today. What did I learn? Now, that doesn't make me go, no, I feel good, I got my butt kicked. It took me about 3 hours to get over the fact that I choked. Let's call it what it was. But then I look back and I said, all right, what did I do wrong? You know what? On the 17th hole, it's a downhill par 3. I hit a fat shot and then a bad bunker shot. I need to get in the bunker and start working in the bunker under pressure. That's my Achilles heel. I'm good out of the bunker in practice, but I'm not good in the bunker under high-pressure scenarios. I got to get better there.
All right, Brett, I can't thank you enough for your time.
Thank you.
And where can we find you? Where can, like I said, I listen to your show pretty much every week.
Good, thank you.
And
so a couple places. You can start at themindside.com, themindside. You can go and follow us on Twitter, same Twitter handle. You can find the podcast at the Mindside Podcast on iTunes,
yep,
or any other distribution site. And we have a book coming out called The Mindside Manifesto, and that's coming out in December, January timeframe. So all that's there, and you can find out more information. But the podcast, we do an amazing job of getting people across a variety. This week was a guy, you know, climbing Mount Everest. In a couple weeks, is a guy who had a tragic accident and his ability to recover. So that we can all learn about overcoming and developing that competitive mindset.
All I need to say is thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much. You got it. Honor.
Wow, alltså jag har sett den här intervjun nu flera gånger, som tänkte jag satt där och pratade med honom och kände verkligen att det här är guld, det här är hur bra som helst och hur häftigt det är och hur viktigt det här är. Du hör på mig, jag är nästan lite starstruck ärligt talat att sitta och prata med en så pass framstående person i ett sånt ämne och helt enkelt få möjlighet att lära sig, och nu har också du den möjligheten att ta med dig det här och lära dig mer utav det. Som sagt, är det någonting så tycker jag verkligen att du ska fokusera på det här. Hur vi ser på våran golf och hur vi ser på våran prestation. Att vi måste sluta basera våran prestation eller om någonting är bra eller inte efter våra absolut högsta nivå. Som sagt, är du en 10-handikappare, förvänta dig inte att skjuta 75 varje gång du är ute. Det är inte där ditt snitt ligger, och då kan vi inte heller förvänta oss någonting i närheten av det. Vi måste bli bättre på helt enkelt ta det för vad det är. Och ännu mer, ge hans podcast en chans och behör. Han är extremt kunnig och vi kan lära oss väldigt, väldigt mycket. Det jag också tycker om att avsluta, jag tycker du kan ta med dig, det är just hur hans syn är på vad vi kan lära oss av som golfare eller som golftränare eller vad det nu än må vara. Försök att titta lite utanför boxen, försök inte bara lära dig genom golf, golfkanaler, golftidningar, golfböcker. Försök att se vad du kan lära dig av så mycket annat, för det finns jättemycket där ute att lära sig. Det tycker jag verkligen är jätteviktigt. Återigen, den absolut bästa intervjun jag har gjort, den jag har lärt mig absolut mest utav, och jag hoppas verkligen att du lär dig lika mycket, för det är verkligen guld värt som sagt. Så länge för att tacka så hemskt mycket för att du tittade. Lycka till med träningen och kör hårt.